Good evening all, and I am Dr. Sanjeev Bhoi, and moderator for this session on welcome to clinical grand round on point of care ultrasound in COVID-19 pandemic. Today we are presenting as a part of Department of Emergency Medicine, AIIMS, New Delhi. So I'll call upon Dr. Roshan Matthew, our senior resident, who is going to take you through the clinical grand rounds. Dr. Roshan.
Thank you, Bhoi sir. So good evening, everyone. Welcome to the clinical grand rounds. Today, Department of Emergency Medicine will be presenting the utility of point of care ultrasound in the COVID-19 pandemic. So on 24th of March, our Honorable Prime Minister declared a nationwide lockdown. Now, more than preventing the spread of infection, this helped the healthcare system a certain amount of time to ramp up their facilities and also address their surge capacities. There were many challenges at the institutional level where the routine OPD and OT services were closed. There were some administrative changes, like that whole level 1 trauma center was closed down and converted to a COVID facility, and the trauma emergency shifted to main emergency, which reduced the number of admission beds for each specialty. There was a significant uncertainty about the disease. Initially thought to be a predominantly respiratory illness, soon we could find patients with acute coronary syndrome and stroke coming as COVID positive. And then there was a fear of infection among the healthcare workers because of the fear of lack of PPE and all, which was addressed by the administration. And also because there was paucity of research at that point of time, there was conflicting ideas between the experts on how to go about things. For the emergency department, the challenges were a little different, because it was the only portal of entry for patients in AIIMS for both COVID and non-COVID patients. So segregating these patients into separate areas in order to prevent cross-infection was very important. And also working and resuscitating a patient in PPE was a new thing for us. So it was a challenge. So providing a continuity of quality care and protecting our healthcare workers was of paramount importance for us. So the first change we did was we divided our screening area into 3 parts. Since the routine OPD services were closed down, we expected a lot of walk-in patients to come in who had mild symptoms or a high-risk contact to just come for a routine testing. Such patients were directed to our screening A, where a resident used to take the vitals, a history, and then gave him advice for home quarantine and gave a government helpline number where they could call and get themselves tested. As our institutional policy, we were not testing patients who were not getting admitted in our hospital. In screening B, we received patients who came with severe acute respiratory illnesses or with patients with high grade fever and who had confirmed COVID-19 cases from outside. These patients were initially assessed by the residents there, resuscitated, and then shifted to a COVID holding area till the time their results came. And the other non-respiratory patients were directed to screening C. Even though the non-respiratory patients were directed to screening C, the healthcare workers were provided full PPE there because at that time we thought anyone could be COVID positive. Now, in respiratory illness, in evaluating the patients, auscultation is an important part, but with the PPE, using a stethoscope was very difficult. Also, it could be a source of potential nosocomial infection which the residents could take back to their home. So the use of stethoscope was out. Now, at the start of the pandemic, the routine bedside x-rays were stopped because we had a machine which catered to all of the hospital. So the machine could not be used in emergency as well as other areas because emergency, there was a fear of spreading the infection. Also, shifting these critically ill COVID suspect patients to a radiological suite increases chance of infection. And after each imaging, the suite had to be fumigated, cleaned, which is time consuming. So this again became a logistic issue. So we tried to find an alternative way. So point of care ultrasound is an integral part of our emergency medicine department training. All the residents become well versed in bedside ultrasound in clinical evaluation of patient by the end of 3 years. So in this current COVID-19 pandemic, it became a boon for us. It acted as a visual stethoscope so that we could see the things which we could not hear by the actual stethoscope. Also, another advantage of using an ultrasound was that it could be easily cleaned by low-level disinfectants, thus preventing cross-infections. So we tried to integrate point-of-care ultrasound in our routine care of highly suspect and confirmed COVID-19 cases. Any patient who came with mild clinical features, we did a point-of-care ultrasound at the beginning. If the lung ultrasound turned out to be normal, we send them back to a quarantine at home and explain them to come back if their symptoms worsened. If any abnormalities was found, we did a detailed evaluation. For an emergency physician, resuscitating a patient in the ABC way is of paramount importance. So we incorporated point of care ultrasound at every step. So in securing the airway in emergency department, we use a rapid sequence intubation. The most experienced operator wears the level 3 PP. If he finds there is a difficult airway, he can assess that using a point of care ultrasound. After pre-oxygenating and giving them paralytic and induction agents, the operator can see the placement of the tube by dynamic and static method. If you can appreciate this image, you can see this is the thyroid, this is the thyroid gland, and this is the trachea, tracheal ring, and this is the collapsed esophagus, and this is a hyperechoic line behind it, which is a normal anatomy of how the trachea and esophagus looks. After once intubated, if there is an esophageal intubation, you can appreciate this a similar looking finding like the trachea. So this is known as a double track sign, and you can again appreciate in both the images the hyperechoic line is absent. So this shows that this is an esophageal intubation. So the operator has to remove the tube and retry again. Also, after the placement of tube, usually the confirmation of tube in the emergency department, we do it by either ETCO2 or 5-point auscultation. Since stethoscope is out of the picture, we use a lung ultrasound to confirm the tube by seeing lung sliding. We also tried to propose an algorithm where we could incorporate ultrasound in CPR. There were many studies which showed that wearing a PPE could impact the quality of resuscitation, and also to see assess for futility of resuscitation in the beginning itself in order to protect your healthcare workers. So at the start of the CPR, we did CPR for 2 minutes, that is 5 cycles, and after that, using an ultrasound, we saw the cardiac activity. If the cardiac activity is absent, the team leader decides if the further resuscitation is futile or not, because this way, by that way, we can conserve our resources. If there is cardiac activity present, then further resuscitation is carried forward and ultrasound is used to look for reversible causes. Also, in our emergency, we used the mechanical CPR device, which is also a boon at this time because it conserves the resources, it provides adequate chest compression, and also prevents infection healthcare workers. So coming on to the lung ultrasound, which will be the focus of our talk today. In this era where CT scan is very commonly done, the utility of ultrasound is usually undermined. In 2004, Leichenstein and his team published a study where it compared the diagnostic accuracy of auscultation, chest radiography, and lung ultrasonography in acute respiratory distress syndrome. They compared the diagnostic accuracy with the gold standard, that is CT scan. In 384 lung fields in 32 patients, they found that the lung ultrasound performed very good when compared to the gold standard CT scan, and when you see compare auscultation and chest radiography, the lung ultrasound performs very, very good when compared to CT scan. In a very recent study published in 2017, the team investigated the role of thoracic ultrasound in diagnosing pulmonary and pleural disease in critically ill patients. There were a total of 130 patients in ICU setting, ventilated and non-ventilated patients, and they found that when they compared the AUROC of clinical examination plus chest X-ray versus ultrasound, they found that the ultrasound performed better when compared to chest X-ray and clinical examination combined. Also, in their study, they found that ultrasound worked as good as CT scan in finding lesions like pneumonia, effusion, edema, and pneumothorax. So this prompts us to find that there is an alternative way and not overly depend on CT scan. This was a landmark study and algorithm which Daniel Lichtenstein proposed, which is the blue protocol, which is called the bedside lung ultrasound in emergency, where an algorithm was proposed through which various lung lesions like pulmonary edema, pulmonary embolism, pneumonia, pneumothorax can be diagnosed easily bedside. So before April, a lot of CT-based studies were done in COVID-19, which told us about the pattern and the progression of the disease. Usually the disease progressed from distal to proximal. In the early stages, we could see ground loss opacities, crazy wavy paving changes. In later stages, we could see larger consolidation and in the basal and dependent lung positions. And all these because of the pathophysiology of an alveolar damage and edema, interstitial thickening and gravitational consolidations. So if you see that because of the peripheral involvement, a surface imaging like ultrasound can be very valuable in such conditions. So a few of the researchers in their limited case series tried to find the utility of point of care ultrasound in such patients. Peng et al, Huang et al and Pogiali et al in their case series compared their findings with chest CT, and they found that they were almost similar. So in replicating such studies in our situation, in our scenario, we found that it is very difficult in a high volume ED like us to get routine CT for everyone. So we planned a study where we decided to describe the various lung ultrasonic sonographic finding in a lab confirmed COVID-19 patient and also correlate those findings with patient's clinical severity. This could address our radiological surge capacity also. So the methodology used was, it was a prospective observational study done in an emergency department from April 18 to May 30th. The data was collected by our emergency resident on the shift who was trained in emergency sonography, and the data was collected in an online data collection sheet. So our protocol used was a four zone method, where in zone one, zone one extends from second rib to the sixth rib in the midclavicular line. Zone two extends from sixth ribs to the 10th rib in the midclavicular line. Zone three extends from fourth rib to the 12th rib in the anterior axillary line, and zone four extends from the fourth rib to the 12th rib in the mid scapular line. We use a lawnmower technique in which the probe was continuously used in all the lung zone without lifting up. This way, which we could not miss any areas where a lung finding can be present. All of our emergency medicine residents are trained formally in an emergency sonography course. But for this study, we did a refresher course so that we could standardize the technique by focusing just on the lung ultrasound. Emergency medicine faculty took a 2-hour class to give us a focused lung ultrasound teaching. We used the Chinese CDC classification for classifying the severity of illness, because at the time when we wrote the protocol, this was the only validated severity score. Where mild cases were defined as acute respiratory tract symptoms which were not meeting the criteria of severe and critical. Severe cases had dyspnea, tachypnea of more than 30 per minute, saturation of less than 94%. Critical patients were respiratory illness, septic shock and multi-organ dysfunction. So out of the 408 patients who came in that time period who were classified as suspect, we did lung ultrasound and RT-PCR for all the patients. 280 patients who were RT-PCR negative were excluded. 22 patients were excluded because of poor ultrasound window. And final number of patients included in the analysis were 106. Out of which 29 were mild cases, 41 were in severe cases, and 36 were in critical diseases. So these are our lung ultrasound findings. On the left, you can see this is a normal. This is how a normal lung ultrasound looks like. These are the rib shadows, which you can see, and then this is the pleural line, hyperechoic line, which is smooth. This is how a normal lung ultrasound looks. On your right, you can see this is the irregular pleural line, which is discontinuous. So this is called as a shred. again, you can see here, these are B lines. These are focal B lines, which could be a normal or an abnormal finding. A focal B line is more common in mild cases. These are this is a image of a B profile, where more than three B lines in a field, lung field, is defined as B profile. And you can also appreciate the broken pleura up here. Next, one of the findings were subpleural consolidations, which we could very well appreciate in such patients. And these are the classical consolidations which we can see, where you can see the, if you can appreciate, there are certain static air bronchograms here and also peripheral interstitial edema. Also, one of the specific findings of the disease was a pleural thickening. Pleural thickening was defined as a thickening of more than equal to 2 millimeters. Here you can appreciate the thickening of 3.1 millimeter. And as the disease progresses, because of the increase in interstitial edema, you can see confluent B lines, which is commonly termed as a waterfall sign. So just summarizing by a schematic diagram, I want to explain. So initially, as I showed you, the normal lung ultrasound, where you can see the rib shadow and the normal pleural line. As the disease progresses, you can see there is irregularity in the pleura or with shred. And then you can see B profile going on. As more and more deteriorates, you can see the waterfall sign. You can see the typical how waterfall looks like, some subpleural consolidation, and the pleural irregularity increases more. And in the advanced stages, there is a consolidation. So all the findings which we could find in our study were pleural shedding, B profile, subpleural consolidation, pleural thickening, B lines, confluent B lines, spared areas. Spare area is where you can see normal lung anatomy in between the diseased lung, which is more typical of an ARDS-like picture. Pleural effusion and deeper consolidations. To make things easy for everyone, we have color-coded for better visualization. If the incidence is more than 40%, we color coded it as red. For incidence of 31 to 40%, we color coded it as orange. For 21 to 30% as yellow, 11 to 20% as cream color, and 0 to 10% as white color. And we could appreciate that the top four common findings which you could find was pleural shedding, which was present in around 70% of the patient, B profile in 60% of the patient, subpleural consolidation in 35% of the patient, pleural thickening in 33% of the patient. When you divide zone-wise incidence of each pathology, we could find that commonly the lesions were more found in the zone 3 and zone 4. That is more in the bases and the peripheries. So this is one of the typical features of a viral pneumonia. So the findings tend to be more bilateral, occurring in lower lung zones. There are pleural line irregularities and brief B profiles are common. When we divide on the basis of severity of the disease, we found that in severe and critical illness, there was more bilateral involvement. Pleural irregularities were present. You could appreciate B profile more in severe cases, like I showed you the schematic diagram of progression. And there are few specific signs which we could see only in severe and critical illness, which were confluent B lines and spared areas. The spared areas indicates that the patient had gone into ARDS. So correlating with disease severity, we could find more bilateral involvement, presence of B profile, and presence of confluent B lines, that is a waterfall sign, and presence of spared areas. So when at the time we completed our study, a systemic review and meta-analysis was done by Mohammed et al, who included 7 studies with 122 COVID-19 patients. And they found that all the studies included by them were retrospective in design. There were pool proportions of B line B profile were 97%, the most common finding. Pleural irregularities were 70%, pleural line thickening was 54%. Subpleural consolidation was 39% and pleural effusion was 14%. So this correlated with our study. We tried to search the literature to find similar findings in previous pandemics of H1N1 and avian flu, influenza, and MERS. And we found that the lung ultrasound findings were similar to our COVID-19 patients. So this indicates that these viral pneumonia has a similar pattern of involvement. Then after our studies, few newer studies which could come were of in adult patient, they did was the Bonardi et al, where they included 54% patients in which they actually categorized these patients and tried to take out the outcome. Like at initial point of contact, what the they graded the severity of the ultrasound finding and said and tried to predict the outcome. So they found that if in the initial part, if the lung findings were bad, the outcome was severe. They predicted ICU mortality and ICU admission. So they proved that lung ultrasound can be used as a prognosticating marker also. Chen, in his one case report, followed a patient of COVID-19 for 35 days till the time he was discharged. He described all the finding, progression of the finding, and said that the lung ultrasound can be very well used without giving radiation to the patient and find all findings in a COVID-19 patient. Chebrian et al. In their 61 patients, used ultrasound to triage the patient. They graded the patient based on ultrasound, and then they decided if the grading is high, they should refer the patient to a place which has ICU facilities. So ultrasound at this moment can be used as a triage tool also. Emmanuel et al, which was a very interesting study, which was published last month, which showed who integrated clinical examination with point of care ultrasound, and they found that it performed better than RT-PCR. So this way, ultrasound can be used as a holistic tool, not only to diagnose, it can be used to triage and also prognosticate the patient. So, and similar studies in pediatric and pregnant patients were done, which had similar lung ultrasound finding like our studies. So the strength of our studies was a prospective observation studies, one of the largest cohort till now. We use a standardized POCUS protocol, where all the emergency medicine residents were trained in a refresher course focusing on lung ultrasound, and also all the images were verified by the emergency medicine faculty. We also did a sonoclinical correlation analysis so that we can use it as a prognosticating marker also. The limitation was that it was a single center study. We used a single arm observational study with no comparison, because that was our goal, because we wanted to address our radiological surge capacity. We wanted to avoid as much as movement of the patient and reduce the use of a CT scan. And there were selection bias, because most of the mild cases were discharged to home. So our proportion of mild cases were less, and in emergency, we tend to receive severe cases. There was also performer bias, but in this pandemic, this was a pragmatic study where we could use whatever resources we had and do the best out of it. So the benefits of conducting this study was that point of care ultrasound helped us to screen, diagnose and prognosticate the disease process. It addressed our radiological surge capacity. We could avoid CT chest in emergency, and also our study gave us an impetus for further research. So in conclusion, we could describe common sonographic findings. These findings were present bilaterally and in the lower lung zones. The characteristics findings were bilateral lung involvement, B profile, spared areas, confluent B lines, and these were significantly associated with the clinical severity. And best of all, we could avoid CT scan in all patients. So we could publish our study in the American Journal of Emergency Medicine, which you can read further. So I would like to invite Bhoi sir to talk further about our point of care ultrasound.
Thank you, Dr. Roshan. I'd like to highlight here, it was the most pragmatic study into which we had planned, because it was the beginning of the pandemic, and considering that it is involving mainly the respiratory tract, so what better could have been the lung ultrasound? That's why, based on our core competencies of emergency department, and also looking at the previous literature and previous pandemics, like, you know, MERS, SARS, and the H1N1, people have used this one as their tool. So what we thought initially when we have planned in the early part of this pandemic was when actually the globally people are using more of CT scans. Even they were saying even CT scans, and that actually had been the norms in the peripheral parts of our country also. even in big tertiary care hospitals, people actually were thronged to straight away subject the patient to CT scanners, and which has got its own share of problems. Because if you do a CT scan, you have to for the next patient, you need to sanitize that for almost 3 hours. And second, the whole radiology shoot will be shut. So it requires increased number of manpower, man hours, and you cannot do it quickly. So considering the fact the pandemic, you need to actually, do it very quickly, because you have to see many, many patients. Patients are actually queuing up in front of the emergency to get to be seen in the screening B, which we had. So actually, whenever you do something new, it is actually based on the problems what you face. So like you say, innovation is the mother of all inventions are actually from the problems which you face. And that's why we thought it more pragmatic. It can be done very quickly by using a low-level disinfectant. All our residents were trained, already trained as a part of core competence emergency medicine. They're already trained in point of care ultrasound. So only we actually standardize their protocol and the operational aspect of it, how to, while doing PPE, how to use the using low-level disinfectant for actually the probe. So the probe was disinfected by low-level disinfectant like sterilium, and the next, you're on for the next patient in 5 minutes. And the duration also doing a lung ultrasound, not much. It took 5 to 6 minutes for one patient. So that means you can screen lot number of patients. So that is what we did actually. So now I'll tell you a little bit about what actually when we did this study, actually we also provided impetus to the global literature, because that time it was heavily skewed to a CT scan. People are underutilizing the actually power of point of care ultrasound. So that is the main objective of it. Yes, it has limitation because it was, as I said, observer bias can be there, but it was the most pragmatic that time. So comparing POCUS is the answer for chest CT. If you see one of the studies by Peng et al., where the findings of lung ultrasound, was not compared, whether how good or, equal to what you see in the lung CT. If you see the thickened pleura, which is either 2 millimeter or more, it is called thickened pleura, it is compared with the lung CT. The classical ground glass appearance of the CT scan can be equated to the multifocal or, all the B profile, to the ground glass appearance. It is more peripherally located. What we found in CT scan, if you can see the lungs on 3 and 4, which Dr. Roshan spoke of, actually it matches with the peripheral locations on the CT scan. So that can be easily done. And if you see the pulmonary infiltration with confluent B lines, the subpleural consolidation, which is seen in the CT scan, can also be seen very nicely at a straight sign, so very nicely described, you can do in lung ultrasound. And you can also make out whether it is translobar consolidation in both lung ultrasound and CT scan. Pleural effusion, yes, we got in rarely in a few patients, we got pleural effusion because it is not a primary feature of this virus, this pneumonia. Because if you have majority primary pleural effusion as a major presentation, you do think the other way, other diagnosis. So multilobar nature you can find in that. And focal B lines, if you find focal B lines, if you find, you have to immediately look at the pleura. If the pleura is smooth and you have focal B lines, that means you have to think it may be normally seen. In case of, one or two, you can see on the basis, lung basis, you can see in normal patients. Because when the ultrasound beam hits the interlobular septa, it creates a B line. But if the B line, single B line, is associated with a broken pleura, that means and patient is symptomatic. This is early signs of, you can see early signs of COVID, in this current pandemic, So that is what it is. And if a negative lung ultrasound, that also is very helpful for you to actually triage the patient, and which are the patients you can have a good negative predictive value and send them home or follow the national protocol. So that is how it is in this thing, though it is not very specific for this COVID-19, but in the context of a pandemic, with this finding, it is very helpful. It is as equal as CT scan, in features and also the diagnostic accuracy. So the study here by Emil et al, you know, where he did a prospective, you know, ED-based cohort study, where he saw the population was COVID-19 patients out of 228, out of which 107 were COVID positive, you know, after one or two RT-PCR. So what they did is the intervention, they looked at whether the clinical GESTART and the POCUS integrated algorithm, and they compared this with the control, with the RT-PCR, the first RT-PCR result. And you see here the sensitivity, you know, of integrated clinical, sonoclinical algorithm is almost 95% when compared to the first CT RT-PCR, which is 80%. And with a good negative predictive value of 95%, we score almost 10% more than the initial RT-PCR. What they did is, they did those who were negative, initial RT-PCR were negative, but there was strong suspicion, you know, some clinical plus focus finding suspicion as an integrated algorithm. They followed up the patient and they repeated the RT-PCR in 72 hours. And what they found is they were able to reclassify almost 15% of the patient, you know, had COVID positive, which could have been missed. Suppose they would have been sent home. So they will be super spreaders, you know, so they'll spread more people. So, hey, I am negative, let me stay at home. So that can cause a problem, you know. So reclassifying was the most telling step in which they found here. So that means, you know, investing on clinical GESTART and POCUS is actually beneficial, which has a high good negative predictive value as well as a high sensitivity. Almost 21 patients were successfully diagnosed by COVID-19, which equated to 15% of the total cohorts. So these are the actually the takeaways from this study. After that, there was actually flooding of a lot of studies internationally. You know, a lot of people were doing lung ultrasound studies, and they have compared with CT scan. There are various studies now are published when comparing. So it is as good as, or, you know, equated to. So it is the answer, you know, that you can do with a POCUS and reduces the surge capacity, radiological surge capacity of doing a CT scan. It is very beneficial because if the asymptomatic people in the peripheries are being CT scan, if you have CT positivity, they are repeating time and again, which is also cost intensive, you know, cost to the pocket of the patient, and a resource intensive. So, and you are required to sanitize this thing, sanitize the patient, suit itself. So that's why it has been it is a very eye-opener study for actually in this current pandemic. It is the middle of the pandemic, so that's why we thought to bring out in the clinical grand round, so that more and more can be the point of care ultrasound can be not only used in lung, but the intricacies of integration with the cardiac, because we know that there are extra pulmonary manifestations of COVID, like patient developing, say, myocarditis. Myocarditis with poor ejection fraction, patient can also having associated pulmonary edema, and where you will also see the bilateral B profile, which will be superimposed on the existing COVID. So this is a dynamic, and you treat them, you know, you treat the fluid over a wet lung, you know, you can see the disappearance of B profile. It is dynamic also. Second way, if the patient has a developed ARDS along with COVID-19, so that means the patient will have, as Dr. Roshan has nicely put it, you will have spared lung. Spared lung, you will see in between, there will be cracky pleura, spared lung, and lung sliding will be poor, which is called a baby lung concept. And once you start, you know, going into the ventilatory therapy, even you can use point of care ultrasound to monitor these patients. Like there will be disappearance of B profile, there will be appearance of A profile. You know, once the appearance of A profile occurs and there is complete A profile, the patient, along with other surrogate, you must see the progress or deterioration of the lung condition. And integrated with cardiac, you know, is very important. And we know that this is also a thrombotic events are very common in COVID pandemic. So you can see that we published, like we proposed the algorithm, sonar algorithm, where we looked at, we are looking at, there can be a thrombotic event, like thrombosis coronary, thrombosis pulmonary, can also superimpose into this critically ill COVID patient, you know, which will also help you to pick it up. You know, whether a patient rests, whether during the COVID management, you can pick that up by using point of care ultrasound very regularly in different shifts. So this, in a nutshell, it is helpful on the front line, front door. As the patient comes to the ER, you can do a sonar triage and quickly, you know, decide the lung ultrasound positive. You take him to the ER, lung ultrasound negative, and the patient is mildly symptomatic, have a high negative predictive value. You can safely do after testing. You can, in the local, as per government regulations, you can do home quarantine. So that will, you know, filter the number of patients entering the emergency, already flooded emergency departments in the country. Second, in the ER, as I said, that you can do the ABC protocol, you know, as we discussed, you can use it during intubation, as a tube confirmation, you can do lung ultrasound, and you can do in volume assessment, you can look at the cardiac for LV, ejection fraction for myocarditis, and myopericarditis. And in the critical care, also you can use it regularly for monitoring and evaluation of ARDS, as well as development of critical events, even in cardiac arrest. So that's why it is so important to use it more often in this ongoing pandemic. So with this, we thank you very much. If there are any questions, we can take. Any questions? So thank you. If there are no questions, thank you very much.